Hi friends, here in this video, I'll be explaining the design of belt conveyor system. So let's get started. Now here is the question given. Design a belt conveyor system for the following specifications. Number one, the material to be conveyed, coal, capacity is 200 TPH, that is tons per hour. Then the lump size of the coal is given. It is 100 mm. Next, we have to carry the material up to a length of 50 meter, that is the length of the belt given, or we can say the length of conveying. Next, troughing angle is 20 degree. What do you mean by troughing angle? That I'll explain further. And inclination angle, this inclination angle is the inclination of the belt. It is 15 degree given. So for this data, we have to design the belt conveyor system. Now how that belt conveyor system looks like, that I'll explain with the help of a diagram. So here in this diagram, we can see the belt conveyor system. First of all, belt conveyor system is used if we want to transfer the material at a relatively longer amount of distance. Means the distance can be from a few meters to up to kilometers. So even if the distance is 1 kilometer, we can transfer the material. And as per this diagram, we can easily see that the material is being conveyed on this belt. Next, the conveyed material, it can be coal, it can be clay, cement, concrete, iron ore, gold or gold ore, etc. The material can be anything which we are conveying from one place to another. And like for example, in this diagram, we can see that the material being conveyed, it is coal and some more information regarding the belt conveyor system will be explained on this diagram. Now in this diagram, here at first we have a driver drum, also called as a driver pulley, rotating in the clockwise direction. Here is the driven drum and this belt is inclined, as we can see here, and the material is being conveyed up. So that is the convention. At first we have to take, or we have to assume that the material is being conveyed up until and unless it is specified in the problem that the material is conveying down. Always we have to take that the material is being conveyed up. Then here there are some descriptions which we have to see, or we can say some parts which we have to understand before designing the belt conveyor system. Now what are those parts? First of all, I'd explain this delta is the belt angle, means the coal is being conveyed at a certain angle. Like for example, in this problem, coal is given. L, as we see, L is the center to center distance, or also we can say the distance of conveying. Then here there is this loading hopper. So what happens if, for example, the coal is falling from this loading hopper? It will fall onto the belt, and in the start we have rollers under this belt. Now since the material would be falling from a certain height, we have impact rollers at the start of the belt. These impact rollers may be 3 or 5 in numbers at the start. And then these impact rollers are going to absorb the shock of the material which is falling, and it will avoid the material from bouncing back. So here we have impact rollers, and further we can have straight rollers throughout, or even the impact rollers can be used. So whichever possibility is there, but at the start compulsory we need to have the impact roller. Then the material is being conveyed up. At the same time, we can see the roller density is more on this top belt. Here this is the top surface of the belt, and here is the bottom surface. So at the bottom we see that there are few rollers. Why? The reason being, the material would always be there on the top side of the roller, so we need to have more rollers on the top side compared to the bottom side. And here at the bottom the spacing is also more. Then on this driver drum, since the material, conveying material, would be passing, so we need to have a cleaning device. This cleaning device can be a brush, it can be a scraper, that depends on the material which we are conveying. So here is the diagram. We can have such kind of cleaning brush attached to the pulley, so that whatever material is being deposited, it gets cleaned from the pulley. And at the same time, we can also have the scraper plates, like the one which is showed here. We can have this cleaner, it is cleaner blade or the scraper plate, we can say, which is going to scrape the material if the material to be transported is, for example, it is mud or gravel, in that case, to avoid sticking onto this driver drum, we are having the cleaning device which could clean the material. Then we have snub pulley. See, snub pulley is used to increase the angle of lap of the belt, because the belt should be in contact with the driver drum, or in order to avoid the slipping of the belt, we have the snub pulley which would be increasing the angle of lap. So by using snub pulley, the angle of lap increases and we can avoid the slipping condition. At the same time, here on the driven drum side, we have a take-up unit on which the weights are attached. So by providing these weights, a constant tension is maintained over the belt and the material is being transported without the belt being sagging or becoming loose. So the tensioning unit is used. Then after that, here is the diagram in which the troughing idlers, or we can also say as troughing rollers, which are the impact rollers, they are inclined, as we see here, or we can say the rollers which are used on the top side, they are in this shape, inclined at an angle of 20 degrees, and this is the standard angle, remember. Next, so the shape of the troughing roller idler or roller is such that we can keep the material over it, because if the belt is straight and the rollers are also straight throughout, then what will happen is the material may fall while conveying. So we are having this bucket kind of shape here so that it can hold the conveying material. So that is the troughing idler, and straight idlers which are there on the bottom run of the belt or the bottom rollers, we can say, these are straight in cross section because they are not in contact with the material being conveyed. So in short, that was the description regarding the belt conveyor system. The next part is, here I am giving the diagram. See, this is the way in which the troughing idlers or troughing rollers look like, as we can see here, over which the belt would be there and the conveying material is kept. Also, these idlers, they consist of metallic tubes or rollers over which, here we have these rollers mounted which are going to absorb the shock, and then after assembling it would look something like this. As we can see in this diagram, here there is a belt conveyor system and these are the idlers, or we can say the troughing idlers in the belt, and the conveying material is being carried in. So that is the description. Now, once we have understood or we have got the knowledge of the belt conveyor system, the first thing which we want in the design is we need to know how many steps are there. I'll make this problem or this design as simple as possible, first by noting how many steps are to be used and what we are going to do in each of the steps. So let's get started with it. So these are the steps which are required. So the first step is, in the first step, we are going to decide or we are going to finalize how much should be the width of the belt and what should be the speed, or we can say the linear velocity of the belt. So this is step number one. Next, step number second. Is motor selection, where we are going to determine how much should be the power and the RPM of the motor which is going to drive or which is connected to the driver drum, because here we need to give power only to the driver drum or the driver pulley, and that drum would be driving the driven drum with the help of this belt. So we need to give power to this driver drum, so we have to find the power of the motor in step number 2 and the RPM as well. Next, step number 3 is deciding the belt cross section. So we have to design or find the belt cross section, that is finding the dimensions of the belt. Next, step number 4 . Here we are going to decide the diameter of the drum, that is the driver and driven drum, the drum shaft and the drum shaft bearing. So that is step number 4. After step number 4, there is step number 5, in which we are going to design idlers, also called as rollers. So, in short, these are the 5 steps which we have to remember in the belt conveyor design system, starting with the belt width and belt speed, second step motor selection, then belt cross section, then the design of drum, drum shaft and drum shaft bearing, finally design of idlers or rollers. So, once we have understood what are the steps, let's get started with step number 1. So, here we have to finalize how much is the width of the belt and the belt speed. For that, we have to read the question. And in this question, if I want to write it in the form of the data, it becomes: the material to be conveyed is coal. Next, the capacity is 200 tons per hour, denoted as capital Q. Then the lump size is 100 mm given. Now, whenever in the problem the lump size is given, lump size means the size of the coal, because here we are going to convey the coal. So, the size of the coal is given to us. So, that means whenever size is given, it means it is graded material. It is called as graded. It means the coal sizes are fixed. They are of 100 mm. having equal size, which are being transferred. Then the length of conveying is 50 meter. The troughing angle is given as 20 degree. So, troughing angle I am denoting it as theta. And the inclination angle delta is 15 degree, which we can say it is also the angle of the belt. Now, once the data has been understood, and remember that here we have graded material. So, how to start the problem for the graded material? Empirically, we have a formula in which the width of the belt is given by now here this is the formula by which we can calculate the width of the belt, which is B is equal to X into A plus 200. This formula is there empirically, we have to remember the formula. And here X value is, it is 3.5 for graded material and it is 2.5 for ungraded material. Now I am putting the values, so therefore B is equal to X, since it is graded material because the size of lump is given, it is 3.5 X value into the size of lump is 100 mm. So, therefore, the width of the belt comes out to be 550 mm. Now, once I have calculated the width by using this empirical formula, now I have to select the standard width of belt from PSG. So, therefore, from the PSG design data book, page number 9.20, we can select the standard belt size. So, here I am also referring to this PSG design data book. On this page number 9.20, as we can see here, on page 9.20, so allowable belt conveyor speeds, so we have the velocities and as well as the belt width. Now, the belt width is starting from 400 mm, then it is 500, 650, 800 and 1000 mm. The answer which we have from the empirical formula is 550. So, select the next higher value. So, after 500, we have 650. So, our value is in between that. So, I am going to select 650 mm as the width of the belt. And at the same time, here the material are given which has to be conveyed. So, the material is coal for us and therefore 650 mm would be the width and 2 meter per second would be the velocity. So, from this reference, I get the standard width of belt as 650 mm. Also, it is 0.65 meter. And the velocity of the belt is 2 meter per second. Now, once I have selected the standard width of the belt and velocity. Here I am going to check if this belt can transfer the required quantity of coal, which is 200 tons per hour. So we have to check if the belt selected can carry this quantity or not. So for that, the reference is so therefore from PSG design data book, page number 9.18, it has the formula. Here we have the reference PSG 9.18, and in that we have to use this formula of B minimum, because what is B minimum? It is the minimum width of the belt. So we have to use this formula. I'll write it over here. And this I am giving it as equation 1. And in this formula, B minimum is the width of the belt. It has to be taken in terms of meter. Q would be the carrying capacity, or we can say the capacity of the belt conveyor. Then rho is the density. So the density is of the conveying material. Remember, this rho is for the conveying material. So in this case it is coal, so we have to know the value of density. Then C, it is called as the factor for the type of idler, and here in this case we have the troughing idler. Angle is given as 20 degree, and V is the velocity of the belt. So one by one I am going to find the values, starting with the density. So therefore, again using the reference from PSG, so from PSG 9.22, the density of coal, I'll write down. So here on page number 9.22, at the top we have density and angle of repose of commonly conveyed materials, and here in the first column we have the materials. So we can see these different materials, and for us the material is coal. As we can see here, the material is coal, and for coal this 18 is the angle of the belt. If it is not given in the problem, but here in this case the angle is given as 20, so we have to take that angle. And if this angle is not given, we can directly take it from PSG 9.22, as we can see here. And this is the density, the unit is ton per meter cube. So the density value of coal is, it is between 0.65 to 0.78. So we can take the average value. So therefore density would become average of the two values, which is 0.715 tons per meter cube. So that's the density of the conveyed material. Next, the value of C. Now C is there on page number 9.18 of the PSG book, and here is C. It is the factor for the type of idler, and the value is 240 for flat belt. Since we don't have flat belt here, we have a troughing angle of 20 degree. So for that the C value is 460. So I am taking the value as 460. Then the velocity of the belt is already known to us. It is 2 meter per second. And then the minimum width of the belt is 0.65 meter. So therefore, putting all values in equation first, hence we have B minimum, Q is what we have to calculate, density rho is 0.715, C is 460, V is 2 meter per second, raised to half, it means it is square root, plus 0.05. So from this I can get the value of Q, which is the carrying capacity of the belt in terms of tons per hour, and the answer is 188.69 tons per hour. Now this value is the calculated value of Q, and the required value is 200 tons per hour as per the data given. So we can clearly see that the calculated value is less than the capacity to be transferred. So it means therefore the selection of belt fails. So now selection fails. It means the belt which we have selected having width 650 mm and velocity 2 meter per second is not able to convey the required quantity, that is 200 tons per hour, as we can see here. So the selection is failing. Now once the selection fails, we have to go on, means the problem would not stop here. We have to go for the next criteria, and that is so we have to select the next higher width. Like previously it was 650, so we have to increase the width, and again going back to PSG 9.20 from where we had selected the width on PSG 9.20. Instead of 650, now the next higher value is 800, so I am going to select 800 mm as the width, and so the velocity will also change from 2, it will be 2.75 Newton per meter per second. So therefore now the next new width would be 800 mm or 0.8 meter, and the new value of velocity will be 2.75 meter per second. Then again for these two values we have to check the carrying capacity of the belt. So again using the same formula like in equation 1, the width would change, C value, density will remain as it is, and the velocity is going to change. So I am putting all the values in equation 1 to get the new value of Q. So therefore where B minimum is 0.8 meter, density is 0.715 ton per meter cube, C value is 460, and now the velocity has changed, it is 2.75. In the numerator we have Q raised to power half plus 0.05. So therefore on calculating the Q value will come out to be, it is 406.89 tons per hour, and again the required value is 200 tons per hour. So now when I compare, I can say that this calculated value is way much greater, almost the difference is double. So the belt which has been selected now having the width of 800 mm and the velocity of 2.75 meter per second can transfer almost double the amount which is required. So the condition has been met, but we have to check the velocity of this belt, means if it is carrying this much amount of material, then the velocity should also be in a particular range, means the velocity should not be exceeding the value of 2.75 meter per second. Then what will happen, instead of conveying the material would be flying away, or we can say the material would fly away from the conveyor belt at a very high velocity. So we have to check that, and for that also I am using the same equation, and therefore keeping the quantity as 200 tons per hour, so checking the velocity, because the material which would be falling on this conveyor belt system won't be greater than 200 per tons per hour as per the requirement. So therefore the belt width is same, density, C value, velocity is what we have to find out, and Q value is 200 tons per hour because that is required. So therefore on calculating this, the velocity comes out to be 1.35 meter per second, and since this value is much less than the design value, which is 2.75 meter per second, it means now this belt can easily convey the required quantity of coal, which is 200 tons per hour at a velocity of 1.35 meter per second, which is less than the velocity which we have designed. If this value of velocity would have been greater than 2.75, then again the belt would have been failing, so we have to go for the next higher width. So now in this case the selection is okay, and therefore the final width and velocity would be belt width as 800 mm and the velocity of the belt is 1.35 meter per second. Now if suppose the lump size is not given, here I am writing an important hint. So here I have written an important hint that if the lump size A is not given, then we directly cannot use this formula of width. In that case, we have to use the trial and error method. In that, from PSG 9.20, we have to select the value of width and the velocity, and then by again using the formula from PSG 9.18, we have to find out the amount of material being conveyed. That will be Q calculated, and we have to compare it with the Q required, which is given in the data. So that is the method which we have to use. Now step number one is completed. Next is step number second, which is the motor selection. Now for motor selection, first we have to reach on PSG 9.18 again. So therefore, so on PSG 9.18, at the top we have the first formula, which is WO. Now what is this WO is given over here? It is the resistance of the belt on the top run. The unit is kgf, so that is the force which is acting on the top of the belt. The formula is CFL G suffix into bracket G suffix G plus G suffix B cos delta plus GRO plus or minus. Now this plus or minus will depend upon the conveying direction. We have to take negative, that is minus, for conveying down. In this case, in this problem, nothing is mentioned. Whenever nothing is given, we have to always take the direction as conveying up. So if it is conveying up, we have to take the positive sign in the formula. So here I have written the positive sign. Then it is H into G suffix G, and then it is G suffix B. So let's start by calculating each of the values. First of all, the value of C. Now this capital C is given over here. It is the secondary resistance factor. And how to get that secondary resistance factor? For that, here there is a graph on this PSG 9.18. Now from this graph we can get the value of C, and I have it on the enlarged scale. So I'll explain it here. On this graph we have the coefficient C versus the length of the belt, which is the conveying length, and whatever the data is there on this graph is being tabulated over here. So in this table, the length of the belt are given starting from 3 meter, and in our case the length is 50. So for 50 meter length, here the C value is 2.2, as we can see here. For 50 meter length, so C value is 2.2, and I'm keeping it as the second C is 2.2. then next is the value of F. Now F is the friction between the idler and the belt, so that values are 0.016 to 0.018. it is for non-portable conveyors with good idlers, and the value is 0.02 for standard conveyors. So we have to select the value always for the standard conveyors, and it is 0.02. so that is the small f value. Next, L is the length of the belt, which is 50 meters. Then after that, G suffix G. Now what is that? Onto this same PSG 9.18, G suffix G, it is specified as weight of the conveying material per meter length. The unit is kgf per meter, and it is also denoted as small q. I have written here small q. So that is the weight of the conveyed material. In this case it is coal per meter length. It means on 1 meter length of the belt, how much is the load acting of the conveyed material. So that is denoted as small q, and for that we have to go on PSG 9.23. here on PSG 9.23 there is this formula of small q, which is capital Q upon 3.6 V, and that is G suffix G. So therefore, from PSG 9.23, G suffix G is equal to small q, it is capital Q upon 3.6 into V, which is the velocity of the belt. Now Q is in terms of tons per hour, that is 200 tons per hour. 3.6, the velocity is finalized as 1.35 meter per second. So on calculating this, the answer comes out to be 41.15. The unit is kgf per meter. So that is the value of G suffix G, and remember, whatever we are doing, it is for the motor selection. It means we have to select the power as well as the RPM or the speed of the motor which would be driving the driver pulley or driver drum. Then after G suffix G, there is G suffix B, which is again on PSG 9.18. We can see G suffix B is the weight of the belt. Previously G suffix G was weight of the conveyed material. Now G suffix B is weight of the belt per meter length. Unit is same, kgf per meter. And this we can get it on the opposite page, that is on PSG 9.19. On PSG 9.19, G suffix B is the weight of the conveyor belt, and it depends on the width of the belt. So the width selected is 800, and the value is 12 for G suffix B. So we have to take this value 12. Unit is kgf per meter. So therefore, it is 12 kgf per meter, so that is the weight of the belt per meter length, and G suffix G was the weight of the conveyed material on per meter length. Then after that, delta is the angle of the belt given as 15 degree in the problem. So belt angle is given. Next is GRO. Now GRO is again on PSG 9.18. here I have written at the end, GRO is the weight of the troughing idlers on the top run, because troughing idlers are used on the top run of the belt per meter length in terms of kgf per meter, and it is on PSG 1.9. the formula is WR upon S. In the older PSG, this formula was not there, so I have written it, but in new PSG we can find, in the new edition, this formula is already given. So GRO is weight of the troughing idlers on the top run. So therefore, GRO is, the formula is W suffix R divided by S, which is the spacing. Next, W suffix R and these S values, they are also found in PSG 9.19. both of them, and how to get the values, that I'll explain. So on PSG 9.19, here weight of the revolving parts of idler W suffix R is what is required over here. On this first column we have the width of the belt. For us the width is 800, so go into this column. Now we can see there are four values, so out of these four values, select the middle two values, and from that select the greater value. That would give us the value of W suffix R, which is 26.2. It is the weight of the revolving parts, that is weight per idler. So that is 26.2. Then S. See, S is the maximum spacing for the idlers on the top run. So here the width is 800, and these are the densities given. So the density of the conveyed material, that is coal, for us the density we have already found out, it is 0.715. so it is in the range of 0.4 to 1.2. so go into this column, and at the intersection of 800, here we are getting 1.5, that is in terms of ton per meter cube. So therefore we have S value as 1.5. on calculating this, GRO comes out to be 17.47. unit is kgf per meter, because WR is having a unit of kgf per idler divided by Now S is having the unit of, it is meter per idler, that is the unit of S. So when it becomes multiplication, here we are going to get reciprocal. So idler and idler will get cancelled and the unit is kgf per meter. So that is GRO. Next is height. See, capital H is the height through which the material is conveyed. We know the length, and for that we can use the simple principle of trigonometry. Now we know the length through which the material is being conveyed, that is 50 meter, but the height needs to be calculated because that is the height from where up to which the material is being conveyed. So therefore, from this geometry, H is what is required. So I'll be using the formula of sine. Sine delta is opposite side, which is H, upon the hypotenuse side, which is L. So therefore, H is equal to L sine delta. Delta is the angle of the belt, which is 15 degree. So therefore, H value comes out to be 12.94 meter. Now once all the values are known, I'll be putting these values in equation number second. So therefore, so when after calculating this, the WO answer comes out to be 839.14 kgf. Now similarly, from the same page, that is from PSG 9.18, the way I have calculated the resistance of belt on the top run, I am going to calculate at the bottom run as well. The formula is, that would be equation 3. So from the same page, that is PSG 9.18, here the second formula is W suffix U, and W suffix U is the resistance of the belt on the bottom run. Previously we have calculated the resistance on the top run. The formula is CFL into bracket GB cos delta plus GRU. Now outside the bracket we have plus or minus sign, and that depends on the conveying direction. Here it is given, we have to take plus sign for conveying down, but since we are conveying up, we have to take negative sign. So I have taken negative minus H into GB. So this is the formula. Now when I look at all the values, we have all the values over here except GRU. So that is what we have to calculate, and GRU is the weight of the straight idlers which are used on the bottom run. And in the start I had explained that why we are using the straight idlers at the bottom. So it is the weight of the straight idlers on the bottom run, the unit is kgf per meter. So therefore, GRU is taken as W suffix R upon space, in a similar way like I had used the formula for GRO, W suffix R upon S. Here I am going to write 2S, and the reference is same, it is from PSG 9.19. Why I have written 2S? Because in case of the bottom run rollers, they are placed at a greater spacing, so the spacing is more compared to the top run rollers. So here I am writing 2S because the space is more at the bottom run. So that's why, and therefore the values are from PSG 9.19. We have to look for straight idlers. Previously there were troughing idlers. For straight idlers, take the width, which is 800 mm, and here we have again four values. So select the middle two values and out of that take the greater value. So 18.2 is the answer, which is the WR value, and the spacing would be same, that is 1.5. S value is same, but it is double because at the bottom the idlers are located at a greater distance compared to the top run, because the top run is carrying the material, so the rollers are closely spaced on the top run compared to the bottom run, and the answer is 6.07 and the unit is kgf per meter. And why we arrive at this unit is explained in GRO. In a similar manner, we have kgf per idler divided by meter per idler. So when we have multiplication, idler goes on top, idler will get cancelled out, and finally the unit would be kgf per meter. So once I have calculated GRU, I can put all values in equation 3. So therefore, W suffix U value will come out to be minus 116.43 kgf. And this negative sign indicates we don't need to apply the force. It means the material will fall due to gravity. So that is why the force on the bottom run is negative, because the material is falling through gravity. And therefore, the total resistance on the belt, again from PSG, 9.18, P is equal to the total resistance on the belt, weight on the top run plus weight or resistance on the bottom run. I'll explain from where this formula comes. On PSG 9.18, here we have P is equal to WO plus W suffix U, and therefore W suffix U is negative. So therefore P value comes out to be 722.71 kgf. Or when I multiply with 10, it becomes 7227.1 newton. So that is the value of P. And remember, whatever we are doing this, it is for the motor selection part. Now once the value of P has been calculated, now from PSG 9.18, here we have this formula, HP of drive. HP is equal to P into V upon 75. Now previously this mechanical efficiency was not there in the older PSG version. It would be there in this updated version of PSG design data book. So here we have mechanical efficiency in the denominator. The formula, I have written it over here. So therefore, putting the values, P should be in terms of kgf, velocity in terms of meter per second, mechanical efficiency we can assume it to be 85%, so that becomes 0.85. that is assuming mechanical efficiency as 85% or 0.85. we can either assume 85% or even 90%, that is also correct. Now from this, the horsepower of the motor comes out to be 15.30 HP. Next, I'll convert it into watts. So therefore, the motor power, because one horsepower is 734.4 watts. So therefore, it is 15.30 into 734.4. So therefore the motor power comes out to be, I'm writing it as MP capital, it is 11.24 into 10 raised to 3 watts, or we can say 11.24 kilowatts. Then after getting this motor power, I have to select the standard motor power. So therefore from PSG 5.124, we have to select the standard motor power. So here we have PSG page number 5.124, and in this column, the first column is having power in terms of kilowatt. Now we see here we have 11 kilowatts. After that, we have the power in the range of 11 to 15, as we can see here. Since our answer is 11.24, so it is very much close to 11 kilowatts. So I have to select the standard power as 11 kilowatt, but it is available in three different speeds. As we see here, 1000 RPM, then there is 1500 RPM, and then there is 3000 RPM. So how to select that? Now, these three speeds are available. In that, I am again multiplying with the mechanical efficiency, taking it as 96%. So 0.96. So it is 960 RPM. So three speed options are available, as we can see here. Remember, whenever in case of motor, if the motor is operated on a less RPM, as we can see over here, that motor becomes costly, because in that case the construction of that motor is complex in order to get the speed reduction. So here this motor having RPM of 960 would be a costly motor. Then for the further option, when the speed is high, in such a case the space required would be greater. So we have to have a compromise between the cost as well as the space. So therefore, so selecting a standard motor of 11 kilowatts power and having a speed of 1440 RPM as a compromise between the cost and even the size or compactness of the gearbox and motor, because whenever these conveyor belts are used, they are used in that space and mostly coal in order to convey it. It would be used in the mining applications. So there the space requirement is not a problem. At the same time, if it is operating at a really high speed, then the space required would be more, but at the same time we have to check for the belt speed as well. So in order to compromise for that, select the intermediate speed, which is 1440 RPM. Now that completes the step number second. So in the belt conveyor system, first we had designed the belt, and now the motor selection part is over. Now going for the belt cross section part. So the third step is, step 3 is deciding the belt cross section. For that, the first thing required is the maximum tension in the belt. So therefore, so from PSG 9.18, again here is the formula of the tensions in the belt. So we have the head drive, or we can say the driving pulley. For that, T1 is P into bracket e raised to mu into alpha upon e raised to mu alpha minus 1. Now in this case, this minus 1 is not in the raised to power, as we can see here. The formula is written over here, so we have to check it. Next, mu is the coefficient of friction. Coefficient of friction between belt and pulley, the value is between 0.1 to 0.4. So it is better to take the average value, because nothing is specified about the coefficient of friction. The average of 0.1 and 0.4 would be 0.25. Then alpha is also there. Alpha is the angle of the snub pulley. Snub pulley, I had explained in the beginning, it is used for increasing the angle of lap. So here we can see, previously I had explained, snub pulley is used to increase the angle of lap for the given belt. So this is the angle of lap, denoted as alpha. So here, so alpha is the snub pulley angle, which is taken as 240 degree, the standard value. Therefore, in terms of radian, multiplied by pi divided by 180, so it comes out to be 4.19 radians. Now putting all values to get T1, P should be kept in terms of Newton. So therefore, P is 7227.1. E raised to mu is 0.25, as I have said, take the average value. Alpha is 4.19, put in terms of radian, minus 1. So therefore, on calculating this, I am going to get the answer of T1, which is the maximum tension in the belt, also called as tension in tight side. 11.13 into 10 raised to 3 Newton, or it is 11.13 kilonewton. So that's the tension on the tight side. Next, similarly, I'll be calculating the tension on slack side as well. It would be required in the further part of the problem. So similarly, on the same page, that is PSG 9.18, so on PSG 9.18, here we have the formula of T2, which is the tension on the slack side. It is T1 minus P1. As we can see here, we can write P because P1 indicates for the head drive. So therefore, putting the values, so therefore T2 value comes out to be 3902.9 Newton or 3.902 kilonewton. So T1, T2 have been calculated, that is the tension on the tight side and slack side respectively. Now, since we are deciding the belt cross section, belts are made up of rubber and there is fabric duct. At the same time, first we have the fabric duct, in between the rubber is impregnated, and the top layer as well as the bottom layer consists of rubber. So there are number of plies or the number of layers in case of the belt. So therefore, from PSG 9.18, number of plies, or we can say the layers, are denoted as I is equal to T1 upon B into F. So going on to the same page, that is PSG 9.18, at the bottom, see the last formula, which is I is equal to T1 divided by B into F. So this is the formula for the number of plies, where T1 is the maximum tension in the belt. We have found out B is the width, it should be in terms of mm, and F is the working tension of the belt for 1 mm width, it is in terms of kgf per mm. And how to get this small f value, that I am going to explain it over here. So first, from PSG 9.21, table number 4 and 5, as we can see here, we have PSG 9.21, here we have table 4 and table 5. So how to get the values? See, here we have the belt width, as well as belt width is there on this column, and inside this table here we have the density of the material being conveyed. So we have to draw the lines. Like for example, there is first column, so connect the first column in this way with the two columns over here. Next, the second column is connected in this way up to the remaining four values. Next, the next two columns are connected with the remaining four values, and finally the last one. So with the help of pencil, you all can make these connections. And now, how to select the value? See, first of all, the width is 800 mm for us, and these are the minimum number of plies. I is the minimum number of plies. So in this 800, we have to check. Now the range is the density which we have. How to start this? First of all, the width has been selected, it is 800, so this is the row. Now to decide which column we have to go into, check for the density. The density of the conveyed material is 0.715 tons per meter cube. It is in this first range, so first column. Now we have two values, 28 and 32. These are called as O's, that it is the designation of the belt fabric. O's value, if it goes on increasing, it means the weight of the belt is going on increasing, and if the weight increases, in that case the life of the belt will go on increasing. It means if the O's value is going on increasing, then the thickness of the belt will also go on increasing. And finally, if the thickness increases, then the life of the belt will go on increasing. So when we have selected 800 as the width, out of 28 and 32, we have two options. Go for 32, higher value, always higher value. Next, in this, reach up to the value of, here we have 800 and the minimum plies are 4. So first I'll explain how to get the plies. And just before that, we have this value as 32 ohms. So we are going for the F value, small f value. So this is the working tension in the conveyor belt, write it as small f. And for 32 ohms, we have vulcanized joint and gravity take up. So we have to assume that here in this case, it is a gravity take up. That is, the tensioning has been adjusted with the help of gravity take up. And vulcanized joint means the method of connecting the belt is either we can connect it with the help of bolts, because belt won't be in a single piece. Like for example, if we have to transfer the material up to 50 meter length, as in this case, in this problem, then there won't be a 50 meter belt in a single piece. We have to use different sections or different lengths of the belt and connect them. So the connection method is either by belting, or we can vulcanize the belt throughout as mentioned here and take the value of 32 ohms. So the value is 0.62 of small f, as we can see here. So therefore, from table 4 and 5, we get small f as 0.62. Again, I'll explain how to get the values. First, go for the density, decide which column we are in, and from that column, here we can see the directions, and out of the two O's values, select the higher value, and we have to reach up till here, that is 32, and then go into this table 5. For 32 ohms and vulcanized joint, the value comes out to be 0.62. Now, therefore, the number of plies would be, this T1 should be kept in terms of kgf. In terms of Newton, the value is 11.13 × 10³ Newton. So that would be 11.13 into dividing by 10^2 kgf. Then the width of the belt, capital B, in terms of mm, 800 mm, small f is 0.62. so therefore I calculated is 2.24. so we have to check if the number of plies are greater than or less than this calculated value. For that, going into the same PSG 9.21, and in this table here, minimum number of plies are given. So for 800, the minimum number of plies, and for 32 ohms, it is 4, and the calculated value is 2.24. So it means minimum number of plies should be 4 for 32 ohms. So therefore, from PSG 9.21, the minimum number of plies are 4, and the maximum number of plies are also given. In 32, your maximum plies are 7. Now, if suppose the calculated value would have been greater than the maximum value, that is, if suppose this would have been 8, then we would have taken the maximum value as 7. But since this value is less than minimum, so we have to start with the minimum value, which is 4. So now the number of plies are fixed. The number of plies we are going to take it as 4. Maximum is to be taken if this value exceeds the maximum value. If it is 8, 9, 10, then we have to take the value as 7 as the number of plies and then do the further calculation. Now, therefore, I'll write the thickness of the belt is given by, once the number of plies are decided, it is I, that is the number of plies, into 1 mm. Which is the thickness of each ply. Like for example, we have 4 plies or 4 layers. So each layer would be having a thickness of 1 mm plus. So this is the formula to get the thickness of belt. So this is the cross section of the belt. Here we have top cover thickness. In between these green section which I have shown, these are the 4 plies I having thickness of 1 mm each. Now in the red which I have shown, that is the rubber impregnation, and then we have the top cover thickness and bottom cover thickness. At the top, since the material is being conveyed, we should have a greater thickness compared to the bottom cover thickness. I am writing the values. So T is equal to, I is the minimum number of plies, which are 4. Each ply is having a thickness of 1 mm. Plus, top cover thickness should be taken as 2 mm. Plus, bottom cover thickness should be taken as 1 mm. And the rubber impregnation should be taken as 2 mm. And why the thickness is less at the bottom cover? Because that is not in contact with the conveyed material. So that's why the thickness is less. And finally, after calculating this, T comes out to be 9 mm. So in the belt cross section part, we have found the thickness of belt, and even the width is there with us, which is 800 mm. Previously we have found out. Now we have to check the belt if it can resist the required stresses. So therefore, I'll write down the permissible now these two values we have to remember, that is the permissible tensile stress for the belt material is 5 newton per mm square, whereas the Young's modulus or the modulus of elasticity is 100 newton per mm square. Now we have to check the belt for the induced stresses, and for that, first the total tensile stress induced is given by T1, that is the maximum tension or tension in the tight side upon the cross section, that is B into T, plus Young's modulus into the thickness of the belt divided by the diameter of the pulley. So I am keeping it as equation 4. Now in equation 4, all the values are known except D, which is the diameter of the driver pulley, and here driver and driven pulley both are going to have the same dimensions because we don't want any kind of speed variation in the driver and driven pulley. So therefore D is the diameter of both driver and driven pulley in terms of mm, and for that I'm giving a quick formula of the diameter, which is K1 into K2 multiplied by I. This formula we have to remember, where the value of K1 is equal to 1.25. This is for the fabric duct ply material of the belt. Then K2 is equal to, the value is 100 for lap angle 240 degree, which is the snub pulley angle, and then I is the minimum number of plies, which is 4. So putting these values to get the diameter, and the answer is 500 mm. Now selecting the standard diameter for the driver and driven pulley, so therefore using the reference, so from PSG 7.54, here on PSG 7.54 we have this table which gives us the value of standard pulley diameters. It is given as nominal diameter. The value which we have, it is 500, and here we can see exactly 500 mm diameter pulley is available. So the value is 500. I can write it as it is. So the D is finalized, the diameter of pulley. Now once the diameter of pulley is known, I can put all values in equation 4. So therefore, the tensile stress value is 3.35 newton per mm square. So comparing it with the permissible tensile stress, which is 5. So this value is less than the permissible value, which is 5 newton per mm square. So therefore the belt is safe under tension. And here also I am giving an important note, that if the stress would have been greater than 5, then what we have to do. So if the belt fails, then select So here is this hint that if the value of stress would have been greater than 5, again we have to go to PSG 7.54, and instead of 500 value, select the next higher value, which is 560, and then check for the given stresses. Because when we look at the stress formula, stress is inversely proportional to the diameter. So the moment we go on increasing the diameter of the pulley, then the stress would be reduced considerably because they are in inverse proportion. And so now it is safe under tension. We have checked the belt. So that completes the step number 3. Now two steps are left, that is step number 4, which is the design of drum shaft and selection of bearing, and step number 5 is the design of idlers. So starting with step number 4. So here in step number 4, we have to design the drum. Already the diameter of drum is there with us. We want the width of the drum, then drum shaft and the drum shaft bearing. So first is the cross section of the drum. So here is the cross section of the drum. This is the driver pulley, or we can say even the driven pulley, because both are having the same dimensions, over which the belt is mounted. Belt is having a width of 800, that has been decided in step number 1. Next, the drum is having a diameter of 500 mm. Its thickness is assumed to be 8 mm, which is called as the wall thickness. Now we have to find out how much is the width of the drum, leaving some amount of clearance. So therefore, so the formula for the width of the belt is, already we have the width of the drum is already we have width of the belt plus 2 into edge clearance. How to get this edge clearance? So these are the three values for edge clearance, depending upon the width of the belt. If the width is less than equal to 650, we have to take edge clearance as 50. If the width is greater than 1000, then we have to take edge clearance as 100 mm. But since the width is 800 mm, it is in between this range. So therefore edge clearance has to be taken as 75 mm. So therefore the width of the drum would become, which comes out to be 950 mm. So here the design of drum is completed. Now going for the drum shaft, because this drum would be having a shaft in between. So within this step, I'll draw the diagram for the shaft. Now here is the diagram of the drum shaft. This drum shaft will fit into this drum, because here whatever is the width of this drum, exactly the same length of the shaft is there. Now extending 10-10 mm on both sides, because here we have to extend the part, this end of the shaft is connected to or keyed to the coupling, which is connected to the output shaft of the gearbox, because the arrangement is in such a way that we have a motor whose RPM is 1440 RPM already selected. So this RPM would be reduced by the help of the reduction gearbox to get the velocity of belt as 1.35 meter per second. So output shaft of the gearbox would be connected over here. So the keyway is given. Similarly, these keyways are provided it would fit into the hub of the drum. Inside this drum also there would be keyway. Here I have not shown in this diagram, but there would be keyway. So the shaft gets fit inside this drum, and the load acting on the drum would be, or on the drum shaft, is exactly at the center, and that load is nothing but the tension on tight side and slack side, which is T1 plus T2. So when this load is acting, it gets divided on the shaft equally on both the parts, like it is acting as a support reaction. So when the load is acting on this beam, we can say shaft as a beam. So when the load is acting centrally, it gets divided equally on both the halves. So we have WDS by 2 on both sides, which is the load acting on the drum shaft. Now therefore, the load acting on the drum shaft, W suffix DS, is T1 plus T2. Both the values are known to us. These values have been calculated before, so therefore W suffix DS, the load acting on the drum shaft, is 15.03 into 10 raised to 3 Newton. It gets divided equally, so therefore WDS by 2 will be 7.52 into 10 raised to 3 Newton, taking the half of this value. Now the shaft would be subjected to combined twisting and bending because the shaft is rotating. At the same time the load is acting, because of which there are support reactions and there will be bending moment. So the same shaft will bend as well as rotate. So it is subjected to combined twisting and bending. So therefore, now since it is subjected to combined twisting and bending, we are going to use the concept of equivalent torque, and for that first I'll find out the maximum bending moment at the center. So therefore, assuming so for simply supported beam with point load at the center, the maximum bending moment is given by WL by 4. And how to get that? It is very simple. Since the support reaction here is WDS by 2, or we can simply say W by 2. So when I take the moment at the center, because at the center it will be maximum bending moment, shaft is bending in this fashion. So therefore it is W by 2 into L by 2, which gives me the answer as WL by 4. W value is 15.03 into 10 raised to 3 into the length is 950 mm already calculated, equal to the width of the drum, divided by 4. So therefore the maximum bending moment will come out to be 3.57 into 10 raised to 6 Newton mm. And now once the bending moment is known, now I have to get the twisting moment, that is the torque. So therefore power transmitted by the shaft, it is 2 pi nt upon 60. So n is the RPM, power is already known to us, it is 11 kilowatts. So 11 into 10 raised to 3. Now how to get this n value? For that I am keeping this as equation number 5, and therefore the peripheral velocity of the drum or the shaft is given by, also we can say the belt speed, it is pi into d n upon 60. So from this formula I can get the RPM, and the velocity is 1.35 meter per second, pi, diameter is 500 mm, so it is 0.5 meter into n upon 60. On calculating this, I am getting the answer of n as 51.57 RPM. So putting all values in equation 5, power is 11 into 10 raised to 3 watts, RPM 51.57 divided by 60. So therefore, torque comes out to be, and remember when power is in watts, torque would be in terms of Newton meter, 2.04 into 10 raised to 3 Newton meter, or
multiply it with 10 raised to 3, so it becomes 10 raised to 6 Newton mm. Now therefore equivalent twisting moment is given by so this is the formula for equivalent twisting moment where KB is the shock and fatigue factor for bending which is taken as 2 shock and fatigue factor for bending and KT is the shock and fatigue factor for twisting taken as 1.5 so putting the values over here so therefore T equivalent will come out to be it is 7.77 into 10 raised to 6 Newton mm. Now in order to get the diameter of shaft I am assuming the material of shaft so therefore so whenever the material is not specified for the shaft we can take it as C45 because if the carbon content would be reduced like if for example we are taking C20 or C30 as the material for the shaft then that shaft would be easily subjected to bending and twisting it means the shape would change very quickly because of the less carbon content so we can increase the carbon content and take it as C45 until and unless the other material if they have specified so we have to take C45 and from PSG 1.9 here we have PSG 1.9 and in this column we have C45 for that we have to select this value here yield stress is given but the unit is kgf per mm square so it is 36 the yield tensile stress is 36 kgf per mm square multiply by 10 and it becomes 360 newton per mm square now stress value won't be this much high because it is the yield value so when the shaft is subjected to this much amount of stress then it can fail or it can break even though the load is removed so we have to avoid so much stress in the shaft so for that assuming factor of safety as 4 so therefore the permissible tensile stress would be sigma yt divided by fos that is 360 by 4 so therefore permissible tensile stress is 90 newton per mm square and therefore the permissible shear stress which is required is half of 0.5 of sigma t permissible so it is 0.5 into 90 and therefore tau permissible will be 45 newton per mm square now therefore since the shaft has keyway so considering the effect of keyway tau permissible would be again reducing it so 0.75 into the tau permissible which has been calculated previously so 0.75 into 45 and finally the tau permissible value would be 33.75 newton per mm square now we have to use this value of the permissible shear stress for designing the shaft so therefore I can write down T equivalent is given by pi by 16 into ds cube which is the diameter of shaft into tau permissible and this formula comes from the strength criteria for shaft that is T by J is equal to tau by R next therefore putting the values T equivalent is 7.77 into 10 raised to 6 is equal to pi by 16 ds cube into the permissible tau which is 33.75 so on calculating this I am getting the shaft diameter as 105.45 so closer to 105 mm I am writing it as 105 mm so that is the diameter of shaft and at the same time we can see that we have found out the diameter of shaft which is
considering the maximum bending moment at the center. So this is the diameter of shaft. Here we are seeing a stepping. This stepping is given so that the bearing can be fixed over it. So therefore, so providing the stepping of 2.5 mm, therefore the bearing shaft diameter, the diameter which goes into the bearing, will come out to be 100 mm. So here the shaft has also been designed. Now the step which is left in this step number 4 is the bearing selection for the drum. So therefore the selection of bearing, in that the first parameter which is required is the radial load, that is F suffix R, and it is equal to half of the load on the drum shaft, which was 7.52 into 10 raised to 3 Newton. Because when we look into this diagram, the bearing would be connected over here. So when the bearing is connected on this diameter which is of 100 mm, the load which is acting is radial, acting towards the center. It is the radial load. So that is WDS by 2, and axial load is not specified. It won't be acting. So the axial load is taken as 0. And since I can say that FR, the radial load, the condition is it is less than 8 kN. As we see here, it is 7.52 into 10 raised to 3 Newton, means it is 7.52 kN. So therefore, we have to select DGBB, that is deep groove ball bearing. And for that, I have to assume the life in hours for the bearing. So therefore, life in hours for the bearing, denoted as L suffix H, I am assuming it to be 25,000 hours. If nothing is mentioned, you have to assume this value, 25,000 hours. So therefore, life in millions of revolutions is given by the formula. It is denoted as L suffix MR, 60 into N, which is RPM, into L suffix H upon 10 raised to 6. RPM already calculated. So the RPM is 51.57 of the shaft. It means the drum is also rotating with the same RPM. So the motor was giving an output of 1440 RPM. As we have selected the motor, we know the speed of the motor. So from 1440, we have to reduce the value up to 51.57 RPM. That is possible with the help of the reduction gearbox. So that is the explanation regarding this RPM. And the life in terms of hours is 25,000. So therefore, it comes out to be 77.36 millions of revolutions. So that is the life of the bearing. And now the probability of survival, POS, is assumed to be 90% unless specified. And therefore, this LMR would be equal to L10. Now from PSG, another formula. So therefore, from PSG 4.2, we have a formula of equivalent load, which is P suffix E, is equal to X into V FR plus Y into FA into S into K suffix T. So from PSG 4.2, we have this formula of equivalent load, wherein X is called as the radial factor. And since the radial load is there, this factor has to be taken as 1. Next, here V is for inner race rotation, and that is also taken as 1.
So x value would be 1 for radial factor, v value would be 1 for, as the inner race rotates. Because we don't have outer race rotation here, it means when the shaft is there inside the bearing, then bearing is fixed and the shaft is rotating, so there is inner race rotation. So therefore V is equal to 1. FR is the radial load, we already have the value, which is 7.52 kN. So I am just going on putting the values. X is 1, V is for inner race rotation, radial factor, radial load is 7.52 kN plus Y into FA. Now since FA is 0 because axial load is not present, so Y into FA becomes 0, where Y is the thrust factor. Since axial load is not there, so thrust is also not there. Then S is the service factor. It has to be taken from PSG 4.2. Here service factors for bearing carrying geared shafts are given. Now for rotary machine with no impact, it is 1.1 to 1.5. So yes, it is a rotary machine. It is not a reciprocating machine. And here we don't have hammer mills. So the value should be in the range of 1.1 to 1.5. Better to take the average. So the average comes out to be 1.3. So service factor has to be taken as 1.3. And K suffix T is the temperature factor. It is the temperature factor. And since nothing is specified about the temperature, we can take that factor also as 1. So therefore, on calculating this, I am getting the equivalent load and my answer is 9.78 kN. And therefore, after reaching up till here, calculation of dynamic capacity of the bearing. The formula is L10 is equal to, it is C upon P suffix E raised to the power K. Now this formula is also there on PSG 4.2 over here, where we have to take K value equal to 3 for ball bearings and K equal to 10 by 3 for roller bearings. Since we are using ball bearings, K value would be equal to 3. And so therefore, putting the values, L10, we have got the millions of revolution, which was 77.36, is equal to C is what we have to find out, that is the dynamic capacity, and equivalent load is 9.78 kN raised to power 3, because this K is equal to 3 for ball bearings, and if it is a roller bearing, the value is 10 by 3. Now from this, C comes out to be, it is 41.68 kN. Now I want the value in terms of kgf, so first I'll convert it into newton, into 10 raised to 3 newton, and dividing it by 10, so it is 4167.20 kgf. Now how to select the bearing? For that I am giving a shortcut here. First, the bearing shaft diameter, the diameter which goes into the bearing is 100 mm, so divide this by 5, simply divide this by 5, so here it comes out to be 20. So now we have to select those bearings whose last two digits are 20, and for that, and starting with PSG 4.12, as we can see here at the top, it is written deep groove ball bearing, so it is DGBB. The diameter of the shaft is 100 mm, and now as I have explained, we have to check for the last two digits having 20. So the bearing selection would be SKF series, last two digits should be 20, so here we have, it is 20, so it is 6020. This is the bearing number, and corresponding to it, we have to select the dynamic capacity. So I am writing it over here. I am writing the bearing number, and the corresponding dynamic load, which would be in terms of kgf. Bearing number first, which is selected, is 6020. Corresponding to it, the dynamic load is 4750 kgf. Next, on PSG 4.13, again the last two digits should be 20. So yes, it is 6220, and the dynamic load capacity is 9650 kgf. Third, on PSG 4.14, here we have 6300, so 6320, and the value is of dynamic load is 13700 kgf. Next, out of these load, we have to see that the load which we have got, that is the dynamic capacity, is closer to which one. So here the dynamic capacity is 4167, which is required, and out of the bearing selected, we can see that the first bearing is closer to this load, and the remaining bearings, they can resist more dynamic load. So if we go on increasing the dynamic load or the bearing size number, then the cost may go on increasing. So selecting a bearing of SKF 6020, so I am writing, therefore selecting a standard bearing SKF 6020, which can resist the given kind of loading or the dynamic load as we have seen here. So with the bearing selection, we have reached up to step number 4. Now only step 5 is left, which is the design of the idlers. So here step number 5 is the design of idlers, and remember here we have two kind of idlers, that is the impact idlers, or we can say the troughing idlers, as well as the straight idlers. So for that, now I am writing that idlers are tubes now the idlers are tubes having outer diameter 140 mm, and their inner diameters are taken as outer diameter minus 2 into wall thickness. So the thickness of the idlers are 6 mm, inner diameter comes out to be 128 mm, and the bearing which would be fitted inside that idler is having a diameter of 20 mm. And now since the top idlers are carrying the material, so they are severely loaded compared to the bottom idlers, so we are going to design the top idlers, in this case the troughing idlers. So here I am going to mention the point. So therefore we are going to design the top idlers, because they being heavily loaded. I'll quickly draw the diagram for the idler, of the top idler. Now the lengths would be kept same of these rollers. At the same time, since we can see that the middle roller would carry the maximum weight of the conveyed material, so I can assume that 70% of the load is carried by the middle idler, and remaining 30 is divided equally, 15-15%, on the remaining two idlers. Now therefore the total weight for one set of troughing idlers is W suffix T is equal to, it is G suffix B plus G suffix G. We have seen previously G suffix B is for the conveyed material, G suffix G is for the belt, plus GRO, that is for the troughing idlers, into the spacing denoted as S. Now previously we have calculated for the top run GB value was, and even for the bottom run it was 41.15 plus
G suffix G value for the belt was 12. So you all can refer the video previously what in which way I calculated GB and GB G suffix G. It was there in step number second in the motor selection part. GRO 17.46 into the spacing, we have to keep it as 1.5. it is in terms of meter per idler. So therefore, on calculating this, W suffix T value will come out to be, it is 105.92. unit is in terms of kgf. Now therefore, here I have calculated the weight which is carried by these idlers, and the next thing is we have to find the length of the idler. So therefore, length of idler is given by the formula. It is 3L is equal to B plus 2 into end margin, or we can say end clearance, because B is the width of the belt which would be there on this idler and some amount of clearance is left. So therefore, the width is 800 plus clearance can be taken as 50 mm. So therefore, the length of idler will come out to be 300 mm. And once the length of the idler is done, so the same length would be kept for the remaining idlers as well. And as I had explained, 70% of the load would be there on the central idler and remaining 30% would be divided equally on the other two idlers. So here, this was the design of the complete belt conveyor system divided into 5 simple steps which I had explained. And with that, the design of the belt conveyor system gets completed, and whatever was seen in these diagrams we had designed. So that was the end of the problem. At the end, if you'll find my videos helpful, you can like, share, comment and subscribe our channel and share it amongst your family and friends. Thanks for watching.